ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the main event. Let's get ready to rumble!
Y'all ready for this? Well, good evening and welcome to the Fantasy Express on 91.3 WCRD. Your host, Blake, the Hound Dog Doll, you're in studio with Robert Segovia. And we hate to break it to you, but this is Rob's last show as he is a graduating senior, graduating early this semester. And Rob, we're extremely proud of you. We're happy for you.
Thank you.
On to Midland, Texas to pursue your career as a journalist, where you will do a fantastic job. So congratulations. We're happy for you. We're going to miss you. How are you doing?
Thank you very much. I'm doing very well. I just applied for an apartment down in Midland, and I'm going to move in with the new meteorologist down there, Dylan Smith. And we're going to, you know, kick it first week, January 7th. And I'm trying to sublease my apartment here in Muncie. So that's pretty much what's going on right now. And a lot of finals.
Yeah, a lot of finals for sure. And I'm glad we can kind of take a break and pull ourselves away from that a little bit. Now, Nathan Gidley's here in studio with us today. Nathan, how are you?
I'm doing great. I'm hoping this mic works right now. Am I coming through?
We're going to have you move over to mic three there, Nathan.
The good old studio.
Yeah, that's for
tech.
Sure.
That's going on. Yeah, I've been busy with a lot of finals and stuff, a lot of meetings, a lot of stuff coming up this week. But in fact, I'm putting off a paper right now, but it's okay. But it's all good. We're going to be talking about sports, and it's great to be here with you guys again.
Now, we're going to have a little surprise here. As most of you have heard Nathan a few times on our show this semester, Nathan, congratulations. Nathan Gidley will be our co-host coming in next semester, filling Rob's shoes. So you've got some big shoes to fill. But you're 6'6". I'm sure you can do it.
Yeah, thank you, Blake. I'm really excited to be joining this program. It's a great opportunity, and I'm excited to be talking sports with you every week. And definitely big shoes to fill. You've done an awesome job here, and excited to work with you one more time today.
One more time, that's for sure. And we're going to miss Rob, but the show's not over yet. The show must go on. Rob is back in studio, and we're going to make this the best show yet on the Fantasy Express. Now, it's coming close to playoff time in the NFL. And what does that mean? That means everybody's getting ready for their Super Bowl party. But before we get to the party, we got to do the work to prepare for the party. And that's what the teams in both conferences are working to do right now. For example, the Kansas City Chiefs, New England Patriots per se, looking to put the finishing touches, clean the countertops, dust off the living room furnace. But other teams, for example, like maybe the Colts, the Dolphins, the Titans, that are on the brink of elimination, are in fact cleaning up their whole house with 5 minutes till the guests show up.
Yeah, and you know, just looking at the playoff picture, Kansas City and New England, like you said, holding those top two spots because the Patriots were able to beat Houston on September 9th, and then rounding out the six playoff spots, you have Houston at 9-3. They could possibly take that spot from New England for the bye, and then Pittsburgh at 7-4-1 in the fourth spot, and then the two wild card spots, you have Los Angeles at 9-3 and Baltimore at 7-5.
And Baltimore is one of those teams that have been up in the air in that weak division that they're in the AFC South. Now, Nathan, I know you have frequently been a critic of Baltimore. What do you see as the problem for the Ravens?
Well, they have so many question marks at quarterback. I mean, it's kind of been this back and forth thing with Lamar Jackson and Joe Flacco. Everyone's kind of like, is Flacco going to come back, you know? So, plus, they've had an interesting running back situation this year where they had Alex Collins starting, and then all of a sudden here comes Gus Edwards out of nowhere, and he's been doing really well for the team.
Gus, so, the friendly ghost, coming out of nowhere there in Baltimore.
So
if you will.
A lot of players coming in and out yet that are somehow sitting right there in position to make the playoffs. So,
yeah, for sure. And the Indianapolis Colts are a team that is on the brink of the playoffs, kind of like I said, you know, they're packing up their house, getting as clean as they can before the guests arrive. Do you think they're going to get that house clean and be ready to go for the playoffs? Or do you think they're going to come up short? Because we've seen scenarios where, you know, like they won five in a row, or as I would say, lost five in a row. But that's an inside joke. Not many people understand that. So anyway, the Colts, like I said, they're, you know, they lost to Jacksonville, though. So question marks for sure. Now, is that going to be an exclamation point where they make the playoffs, or a big question mark that leaves the Colts hanging, you know, to that position where they miss the playoffs but end up with a bad draft pick as well?
Blake, I really think they needed to win that game in Jacksonville.
It was a must-win against a 3-8 Jacksonville team.
I do, because you look at their schedule coming up, you got at least the next two games, you have Houston that's just on fire.
And then Dallas.
And yeah, Dallas, they're fighting to make the playoffs too, so it's they're going to be tough games to win. I think they can win their last two games, but they're obviously it's the playoffs have already started for the Colts, in my
opinion.
Now,
we'll touch on Dallas, too, a little bit, because later on in our question segment, we do have a question, or should I say a statement, regarding Dallas. We'll get to that a little later, though. We want to go through some clinching scenarios. Now, Rob, I know you talk about the Chiefs a lot and Patrick Mahomes as you were all over the guy early on in the semester. You really thought he was something special, and you turned out to be right. They can clinch a playoff berth with a win, tie, or a Miami Dolphins loss or tie, combined with a Colts loss and or a Titans loss or tie. What do you make of that?
I mean, I think Kansas City is pretty much a lock for the number one seed. What I'm more interested in is the Patriots and the Texans. So New England,
three teams,
right? And for Houston and the Patriots, they're going to battle it out the whole rest of the season. And I mean, even the Chargers too. They're sitting at 9-3. I just think the Colts really need to, like going back on what Nathan said, I think that the Colts really needed to win that Jacksonville game because they got the Texans right now.
Right, exactly. And if you can't win against Jacksonville, who's currently sitting at last in that division, how do you expect to beat Houston on their own field with Deshaun Watson playing as well as he is and the Colts showing the inconsistencies that they have? That was a must-win game, and they simply didn't get the job done.
Rob, I'm surprised that you would say that the Chiefs are a complete lock for that one seed. Because it's like,
Wait a second. Are you saying they're not a complete lock for that one seed?
Has everyone forgot about the Los Angeles Chargers here? I mean, they're only one game back from the Chiefs, and
yeah,
they just
the
went
NFC.
On the Chargers are in the NFC. That's
the
Rams.
Oh, the Chargers. Okay.
Yeah.
Clarification.
I always forget about the Chargers, to be honest.
Yeah. I mean, they just went on the road and had a huge win in prime time at Pittsburgh. So,
I mean, I feel bad for Phillip Rivers because his whole career he's been a great player, and now the Chargers are, you know, getting close to that playoff spot, but I still forget about them.
Yeah, we'll see what happens when they play Kansas City another time. That'll be an interesting game.
Well, as I said last week, if Phillip Rivers plays Kansas City, he'll be crying some rivers. So we'll see about that, and we'll see how that ends up for him. Now, we have some elimination scenarios as Rob's over there losing it. The Tennessee Titans, they're at 6-6. Now, okay, folks, we have a good time on the Fantasy Express. So I just want to say, this is some of the things that I think Rob and us will both miss working together. Rob's worked with me for a long time now, and since I came on the Fantasy Express, he was the one that helped start the whole thing. So, you know, there's some history that dates back in some of these jokes and comments. So take everything you hear with a grain of salt, but it's a lot of fun for us. So back to football before we get too far off task. The Titans are 6-6. They will be eliminated from the AFC South contention with a loss combined with a Texans win or tie, or a tie combined with the Texans win.
I mean, personally, I think the Titans are going to be a tough team to beat. I think that whole AFC South is going to be a problem for everyone in that same division.
Absolutely.
Personally, I know the Texans are the best team just by record too. But the Texans even have the best shot to take out a team for that conference championship.
For sure.
I've been saying that for a while now. But between the Titans and the Colts, I would take the Titans simply because of their running game.
And you touched on when going about the Texans having a chance to beat some power teams in the AFC. You said earlier in the year they could beat New England. And the way that New England played against Tennessee when they got shut out a few weeks back really proves to be true. And you made a good point there. I wasn't really quick to buy into that, but really I think that that is a factor and a force to be reckoned with there in the AFC is the Texans.
Yeah, absolutely. Texans are, I mean, how many have they won in a row? Like 9 or something?
Yeah, because they started the season 0-3. And, you know, one of those beating the Colts, but we don't want to talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, the trade for Demaryius Thomas has been really good for the receiving core there. And
yeah,
the
they really received a good player with that trade.
That's right. And, of course, Deshaun Watson, man, he can do it all. It's either he can throw it, he can run it in. And Lamar Miller's come on, too, in the running game. He had, like, a 97-yard touchdown run the other week.
So. Arguably one of the best young, you know, trios in the league. Duos, trios, if you will. Now, the Miami Dolphins, they're another team to watch, as they are sitting at 6-6, and they'll be eliminated from the AFC East title contention with a loss or tie, which, you know, for all intensive purposes, they would be out at that point, and they're not going to pull ahead of New England. Let's be realistic, folks. The Bengals, who started the season hot, are ending the season not, as they will be eliminated from the AFC North title contention with a loss combined with the Steelers' win or tie. Well, I'll tell you what, the Steelers are playing some pretty good ball right now. I don't think that we're going to have to worry too much about them winning or tying. So they'll be eliminated from the title contention there and essentially the playoffs.
Don't get me started about Marvin Lewis again.
So. Yeah, Marvin Lewis, we talked a little bit about him before the show, and you said he should have been fired, what was it, 5-10 years ago?
How does Mike McCarthy, who's won a Super Bowl, and Marvin Lewis has been tenured longer than McCarthy, and yes, Marvin Lewis hasn't won a playoff game. I mean,
and then Joel Quenneville.
Yeah. Oh, gee.
Oh, the Chicago Blackhawks. Nathan, you look like you're about to cry over there. My goodness. But now, a team we didn't expect to win as many as they have, and they still haven't done well, are the 4-7-1 Cleveland Browns. They'll be eliminated from playoff contention with a loss and a Ravens win. Well, the Ravens are currently sitting at that final wild card spot. So if they could just win another game, the Browns are essentially out. And, you know, you can't tell me that the Browns are going to win out the rest of their season. I can't even say that with a straight face.
And if they do, Blake, you know how many people are going to be at your door? Except they don't know where you live. But some of our listeners do because they live with you.
Well, they're gonna be at my door, and well, that means they know where you live too, because you happen to live upstairs from me. So
it's a situation there. But
Nathan, how would you feel about taking the show by yourself next semester? Anyway, Jacksonville. Speaking of the AFC South, they cannot win the title. They're screwed in that regard. They're 4-8. They'll be eliminated from playoff contention with a loss to the Titans or a tie, and a number of other scenarios playing out, which, quite honestly, our show's not 24 hours long, so we don't have that kind of time. So we'll leave it at that. Jacksonville, you might as well tuck your head in between your legs and kiss your rear end goodbye at this point, because you're not going to make the playoffs. The Bills, another 4-8 team. They you know, it always makes me laugh. They say they're in the hunt, as if they actually have a legitimate chance of making the playoffs. Because, let's be honest, they don't. The Bills, led by Nathan, formerly Nathan Peterman, now by Josh Allen, 4-8, they're basically out.
I'll give Josh Allen a little credit. He's played really well the past 2 weeks. He's just come up a little short, but he's got a good connection with some of the young wide receivers there, so something to build on maybe for the future there in Buffalo.
They just need to avoid that loss or tie this week 14, and then, you know, maybe they'll have a slim chance to none, but I think Slim's already left town.
Yeah, and last team to round out the possible scenarios, the Jets at 3-9.
Ooh.
I'm surprised they're not already. I mean, obviously, mathematically, they're not out, but like they should be in the same category as the
they're
Raiders.
They're not in the hunt. Like, you're exactly right.
Then there's the Raiders.
Yeah, the Raiders, the 2-10 Raiders.
The only team that's already eliminated.
I mean, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. They suck. They're absolutely, I mean,
they're a dumpster fire.
They're a dumpster fire. There
they
we go.
They should rename their team.
The Fantasy Express. Yeah, the Oakland Dumpster Fires. I think that sounds pretty accurate, you know. But yeah. I mean, really, the Oakland Dumpster Fires, as they've won two games. Who did they win? Didn't they beat Arizona?
It's a bet. I can't even tell you who they beat.
Well, I mean, there's probably good reason for that.
I mean, I could go on a rant here about John Gruden getting that job, but
yeah, John Gruden has contributed to the downfall of that team.
I thought they had something good going with Jack Del Rio before they fired him, but
you know, I thought so too, because didn't they have like one or two playoff appearances?
Yeah.
And that was when Derek Carr broke his leg in the wild card round, and that was unfortunate, but I don't think your quarterback breaking his leg is a good excuse for, you know, firing your coach. That just doesn't make much sense to me. But enough with the Raiders, because dumpster fire, like we said. So anyway, we're going to move on to the NFC. As the 6-6 Panthers, they're basically eliminated as well. We're not going to go through all of these because, quite honestly, we want to talk about more fun things. And these guys are cracking me up over there. They're waving their arms and making gestures at me. So we're gonna try to keep our composure here on the Fantasy Express like we do oh so well. The Packers, led by formerly Mike McCarthy, now
Joe Philbin.
Yeah, now Philbin is the leader of the coach of the Packers. Green Bay, they're gonna be eliminated from the NFC North title contention with a loss or tie combined with a Bears win or tie, and I'm pretty sure it's safe to say that the Bears are gonna win.
Well, yeah. Actually, you know, looking at the field, Los Angeles is sitting in the first spot at 11-1. They already clinched the NFC West. New Orleans at 10-2 in the second spot. And then Chicago sitting there in that three, with that three seed if the season were to end today. That's really surprising. If I were to look at the season, you know, preseason, I was saying Chicago might get 6 or 7 wins as the season were to end.
Right, because I think you predicted they would be 6-10, and I think I said that they might be like, I think it was 7-9 potentially,
yeah,
at best. Or no, maybe I was on the lower end there. I think I might have had them at 4 wins for the season. Nathan, what was your outlook? I mean, did you see Chicago getting this far?
I thought they would have a good year, but I didn't think we'd be sitting here in December looking at them as the 3 seed. I mean,
no, absolutely not.
That's really good. You know, looking at Matt Nagy running that offense, I really like how he uses the players in his offense. You got Trubisky, he can run around and throw, and then you got Cohen and Howard. Cohen is a nice spot. He can kind of run some receiver routes too. So he's got a kind of unconventional offense, but you know, it works.
Right. And don't forget about the D of Chicago too, with Khalil Mack.
I think that was the key game changer for them for the season. That's what really, you know, turned it around and made it a winning season outlook.
Yeah.
Before that, I think they might have finished 6-10 or 7-9.
For sure. The D is the key for sure, as defense wins championships. They say it over and over. And that saying has really stood the test of time.
And it's not like one player can do everything, but I think he had so much of an influence to make everyone else better around him. And everyone's, you know, they're all young, and Khalil Mack is leading that team, and they're the ones who push the defense up.
Between a young quarterback and a strong defensive core, you're going to be set up for success, no questions asked.
You look at the last time the Bears made the Super Bowl. I mean, they had an excellent,
Super Bowl 41.
An excellent defense, and they had Rex Grossman at quarterback. I'm sorry.
That is gross, man. That is gross.
No, that's exactly right. And we had Cedric Benson running our backfield, and it was just a bad time.
I think Cedric Benson might have been a little better than Joseph Addai, just not Dominic Rhodes.
Yeah, and Rex Grossman, I don't even know what happened to him.
Yeah, I think he like
I
fell off.
Still alive.
I think he fell off the edge of the flat earth or something like that.
He fumbled the snap.
Whoa. Oh, Nathan Gidley coming in with a slam. Now, we've got some more teams that shouldn't even be in this conversation. The 4-8 Atlanta Falcons, 3-9 Arizona Cardinals, 4-8 giant dumpster fire New York Giants. And I can't even fathom why they even list them as in the hunt. We know they're going to lose. I think they just need to rip the Band-Aid off instead of soaking it in the bathtub for 2 hours.
Yeah, Blake, looking at the rest of these teams that are pretty much, you would think, eliminated. I mean, the one that sticks out to me that's surprising, the Atlanta Falcons. I mean, what do you think about that?
Well, I think that Dan Quinn needs to be fired, quite honestly, because he's not leading a Matt Ryan-led offense very well. I mean, you have one of the best quarterback wide receiver duos in the league with Matt Ryan and Julio Jones. And you mean to tell me you haven't bothered to win five games?
Exactly. And they have a ton of pieces. They should have around 7 or 8 wins. I'm not saying they should make the Super Bowl again because all the other teams in the NFC are really good. But come on.
They lost to the Browns.
Yeah. Ooh. That one hurts. That is a ripping the Band-Aid off right there, just like we do on the Fantasy Express every week. Now, the Cardinals, I've always said that the Ball State Cardinals could beat them. And you know what? I think that's true because they are 3-9, which they already can't win the NFC West. So why even bother trying to push for a wild card? I think the only card they need is the one that they draw to get the first round pick.
I mean, that's what I've been saying. Same thing for the 49ers. Speaking
of tanking, we're going to get to that in our prejudice segment a little bit later. Now, games to watch this week, Ravens-Chiefs, going to go with the Chiefs. I know we said this earlier, Chiefs. Patriots-Dolphins, we also said this earlier. Wow, we're foreseeing what's going to come up later in our show. Imagine that. Patriots-Dolphins, we all around said Patriots. Colts-Texans, I'm going to go with the Colts, guys. You know what? Wow. I am bold. Mm-hmm.
Texans are too hot. Like Nathan said, I mean, 9-game winning streak. I think they're too good for the Colts.
And it's going to come to an end this week.
You think Andrew Luck's going to have a little bit of luck?
I think so. Well, I mean, it's Andrew Luck's not really the problem. I think it is some certain favorite people of mine that I like to tweet about.
I mean, I guess it depends on whether they go for it on fourth down.
Okay. Don't remind me. I did not need that. You're traumatizing me.
Blake, how did that go with... Didn't you have one person bickering with you on Twitter about the Colts game?
Oh, I got into a little bit of a feud, but you know what? I corrected their grammar, and that pretty much ended that right there.
There you go. Using your journalism degree to the max.
That is right. I passed the loop test. I passed it by 2 points, so I'm now allowed to continue on with my journalism career. Eagles-Cowboys, that'll be a great game. And, you know, I want to tell a little story because I have an uncle that lives near Dallas, Texas, and... he told me a story that whenever the Eagles come to town, all of the grocery stores eliminate Philadelphia cream cheese because that's how big the rivalry is. What do you guys think of that?
I mean, I just don't like cream cheese to begin with. So.
Oh, I could eat it out of the tub. Just like,
oh my God.
It's like the kid on Grown Ups where he's like, this is some really good ice cream, Dad.
So do you like sour cream too?
I do. It's just like cream cheese, but without the cheese and with the sour.
By cream cheese, do you mean the Eagles secondary?
Whoa! Nathan Gidley with a slam once again. Wow. You know, when you came on and co-hosted the full show when I had my concussion, you were doing this to me, so I appreciate you doing it to other people, too.
Yeah, I'm going to have to pick the Cowboys just because I don't know if I trust that Eagles defense and the way the Cowboys defense has been playing, too. I mean, hometown represent with Jalen Smith. He's been playing really well for that defense. So I'm picking the Cowboys.
Definitely. How about you, Rob?
I'm going to have to go with the Eagles only because, okay, we're going to get into this question right now. So Lily Rogers, Blake's roommate, you know, she said at the beginning of the season, what do I think about the Cowboys? What's my prediction?
And you
them?
Said 7-9, and I said 9-7.
Yeah, I said 7-9, and at the beginning of the season, it was looking like it was going to be right, but they got hot. I will admit that. Cowboys are looking good, but I still want the Eagles to win because I need them to go 7-9. If they can lose all the rest of their games, they might.
And what do you have to say to somebody who gives you that kind of advice?
Well, I don't take sports advice from people who lay on their kitchen counters.
Whoa! Slam on the brakes! What? Rob just went there, ladies and gentlemen. He just brought out the big guns. This show is getting intense. I don't know if I'm going to be able to handle it. The Fantasy Express, rated
R.
I'm
sure there's a lot of confused people.
Well, if you follow me on Instagram, which you all should,
yeah, there you go.
Then you would understand. That's all there is to it. Rams, Bears. We all went with the Rams, and Rob, you went with the Bears. Wishful thinking, I assume?
Yeah, not the Bears.
Vikings, Seahawks, I go with the Vikings.
I mean, I think the Seahawks might take that one. The Vikings haven't been looking like the Vikings this season. If they were like their team last season, maybe, but no.
I feel like this one's a toss-up, but I'm just because of Seattle's at home, I'm going to pick the Seattle.
Yeah, I'm going to go with the Vikings and disagree with you both like I do so frequently. You guys tend to gang up on me, but that's all right because, you know, two co-hosts and against the host, I mean, that's two against one. You guys win. So anyway, we're going to take a break. We will be back. Don't go away.
This message is for all of you sitting in the passenger seat. And apologies if it gets a little uncomfortable, but how does it feel to be at the mercy of someone who thinks a random text is more important than your life? Someone who takes their eyes off the road while speeding along in a 3-ton hunk of steel. Freaky, right? Well, why not just ask them to stop? Or better yet, volunteer to text for them. It might be a little awkward, but believe me, you'll live.
Learn more at StopTextStopWrecks.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Remember, when you need a ride, you can always ride with MITS, the Muncie, Indiana Transit System. The MITS bus goes everywhere you want to go. 14 routes cover both North and South Walmart locations, downtown, Ball State, Ivy Tech, Muncie Mall, and many other locations. Remember that students always ride for free with MITS. Visit MITSBus.org or download the MITS Time app for current route information.
When I ride with MITS.
And welcome back to the Fantasy Express on 91.3 WCRD. Rob, I have a comment back from you real quick. It's Lily. She commented on the live video. She said you just made her day, even though you just roasted her.
Well, that's great. I mean, I'm... Lily...
I was hoping you'd take another shot.
I mean, you're a great person, Lily, and I just want to shout you out for being a great person to see in the parking lot and, you know, all the time in the V. Just saying hi. It's a really good time.
That's fair. That's fair. And that's kind words. We're not going to let this feud burn out of control. We're going to throw a little bit of... we're going to get out the fire extinguishers. Now, again, the Fantasy Express is now rated R. So, speaking of the letter R, the word recap. Nathan, can you tell us about Tiger Woods' season recap?
Yeah, we're going to be talking about some PGA Tour action here. So... Tiger Woods, man, to come back. It was a pretty amazing year for the first year back from injury. Finished out with 7 top tens, 2 runner-up finishes, one of which was the major at the PGA Championship. And then that big victory at the end of the season at the Tour Championship. Man, you look at his rise in world rankings. He goes from outside the top 1,000 to now ranked number 13 in the world. I mean, it's incredible. And... although some struggles to end the year, I could tell he's a little worn out at the Ryder Cup and here this last week at the Hero World Challenge. But the big story, Blake, if I don't know if you saw any of this, it was the match. Did you get to see any of that?
Now, unfortunately, I didn't see it as I had a boatload of homework that night, but I did hear about it. And sigh. I wanted Tiger to beat Phil Mickelson so bad because he's been... my biggest rival as a golf fan my whole life growing up. I've always loved Tiger Woods. And, you know, I always wondered, because I've bowled throughout my life, I always pump my fist after I throw a strike or something, and I wondered where that came from. But I realized I watched Tiger Woods growing up golfing during my younger days, and it's like, oh, that's where it came from. Came out of nowhere. But, you know, just a random thought for you.
Yeah, it was a great match with him and Phil. It actually took 22 holes, and they finished in the dark playing off the putting green. So yeah, it was interesting for sure, but congrats to Phil for getting the job done there. And been an interesting season on the tour. We had Brooks Koepka in 2 of the majors, Patrick Reed taking the Masters, Molinari take the Open, Justin Rose winning the FedEx Cup. And it's actually a wraparound season now, so some players got started here in the fall. So saw some wind drought snapped, and a battle for the world number one continues between Justin Rose and Brooks Koepka. But
he really rose to the occasion.
Absolutely. But obviously, everyone's big question is like, what's next for Tiger? So he's talked about this week a reduced playing schedule. He actually played 6 out of the last 7 weeks in a row to end the season, so that's quite a bit. So at the moment, he's only going to play the 4 majors in the Genesis Open, which is hosted by his foundation. But Blake, what are your expectations for Tiger?
You know, I think he's going to win not one, not two, but 3 majors this upcoming season.
Wow.
You know, kind of like you're on Mike 3, he's going to win 3 majors.
Well, Blake, real quick, I can tell you the schedule is next year much different compared to what it was this year, and it would support a player getting hot like that. So schedule changes now. They're trying to finish the whole season before the NFL starts. So PGA Championship will move to May. The Players will be in March. New events in Detroit and Minneapolis, and the season's going to end by late August. And
that is a bit different because usually, you know, like this year, it went on and on and on.
Yeah,
and it's finishing in what, October? November?
Yeah, late September, early October is when it finished up. So I think the fact there's only 3 playoff events, too, at the end. And then
makes it a lot more interesting.
The season shorter, yeah, that's going to be good for the players like Tiger, who's like, man, he was really burned out at the end of the year.
Oh, yeah, and that happens to the older players. It's, you know, a young man's game in that respect. But when it comes to experience can sometimes edge out that young blood. Now, we've got a couple NBA updates for you. We're going to zoom through those pretty quickly here as we are short on time, and we've got a little segment here coming up, a little specialty. Kyle Lowry opened up last night about DeRozan being traded for Kawhi, basically saying that, you know, he missed him, but he was happy with Kawhi, Rob.
Yeah, so he got a call from DeMar DeRozan at 2:30 in the morning when the trade took place, and you know, he opened up to Rachel Nichols and said they sat on the phone for a while in silence. And that's really, you know,
very sad.
Yeah, it characterizes how they both felt. You know, they were brothers and on the basketball court and off of it. And just the fact that they got Kawhi Leonard and Danny Green in return. And they've been playing really well in that first seed, just like they always do. But I think, you know, Lowry loves the fact that maybe Kawhi will help them get to the NBA Finals this time. But I think,
if he's a one-year rental, none of that matters in the future.
Exactly. And they don't have to deal with LeBron. So even if they did have DeRozan, I think they would still make a push.
I think so, too. Now, I'm going to rattle these off real quick. The Bulls fired Fred Hoiberg. They're 5-20 at this moment, 20% winning percentage this season. Now, Rob, you were at the game against Indy, and Indy put it to him without Oladipo, beating him by 6 points. Now, I remember you said you wanted them to tank, as you feel that's the best option at this point. Now, the Lakers, someone who is not tanking, they're looking to trade Lonzo Ball, Brandon Ingram, and Kentavious Caldwell-Pope for maybe John Wall to the Wizards. That would sort of fill that void of point guard that Lonzo and Rondo have left.
Yeah, I think that the Lakers should have tried for John Wall in this past offseason, even the season before. But, I mean, I love that John Wall would be playing with LeBron, a lot of alley-oops there. I like that deal.
That's right.
How can you trade LeBron Lonzo?
Lonzo.
I can't wait for LeVar Ball to be gone.
I mean, don't we all? That would be a dream come true.
If he goes to Washington, D.C., I think he would be having a lot of problems over there. He loves the L.A. life.
I think so. Yeah. And I don't know, the Secret Service may run after him if he's in D.C. I mean, who knows? I mean, he's not going to last long with the way he runs his mouth. I mean, maybe if he ran like his mouth, he'd be in good shape.
Or he might be in the NBA.
Whoa!
Whoa!
You know, it's 2.2 points per game in college that he averaged, I think it was. We won't talk about that, though. But what we will talk about is the Ball State men's team defeated Loyola Chicago last night, 75-69. Now, everybody says, oh, it's just Loyola Chicago. They're not a very good team. Well, I got news for you, ladies and gentlemen. If you paid attention to basketball, they made the Final Four last year. Ball State has a chance at the Final Four. What do you guys make of it?
Blake, Sister Jean is ours now.
That's right. She is. She's a Ball State fan. And I saw on Twitter she was saying, go Ball State, facing Beneficence.
Shout out to my sister. She actually went to school at Loyola, and She got to see Sister Jean a lot near the bus stop. So
that's interesting. I didn't know that.
Conversations and all that stuff. So, Sister Jean, big shout out to you too. But yeah, I'm very surprised that Ball State was able to take down Loyola. They lost some players last season, but I just think that Ball State was able to add a few, and they even
KJ Walton especially.
Yeah, they added to their repertoire of beating 22 Notre
points,
Dame.
A career high. Yeah, and yes, and you know what's ironic about that is that that was exactly 1 year later, to the day, 365 days.
Yeah, and the fact they did it on the road too, it's very impressive. Yeah.
Now we're gonna cut to our Pride and Prejudice segment. We're gonna kind of chop it up short here, so we will have that in just a minute. Let the suspense build. It's the final Pride and Prejudice featuring Nathan Gidley and Robert Segovia. I'm going to kick it over to him. Nathan, give us the Pride segment.
Yeah, for our Pride today, very inspiring stuff here. Two guys coming back from a pair of spinal injuries. We have Ryan Shazier. We saw a video of him today deadlifting nearly 1 year after his devastating injury, and he was only given a 20% chance to walk. So very cool to see that today.
Fantastic. Inspirational story for sure.
Robert Wickens as well is an IndyCar driver. He continues his recovery after a huge crash in August. He was taking multiple steps last week and having some fun on Twitter there with a little wheelchair competition with a fellow driver. So give him a follow. It's a really cool story to see these two guys coming back.
Absolutely amazing. Now, Rob, you wanted to do the Prejudice to kind of go out with a bang, so go ahead and unleash your fury.
Okay, on Monday, I was going to go to the Bulls and Pacers game. No, Tuesday, my bad. Okay, so I saw if the Bulls win out most of the season, they had a record there, don't look at it, they can make the playoffs. No, why would we want to make the playoffs? We're already 5-20, like you talked about earlier. I don't want them to win the season. I don't want them to win. As a fan of a basketball team, if you're that bad starting out, you can just tank for the number one or number two spot.
Exactly right.
We have a chance to get either Zion Williamson, RJ Barrett, or Cameron Reddish from Duke. And they're all from Duke. And I would be more than happy with any of them as shooting guards and small forwards.
How about Zion?
I would love him. And, I mean, just filling him in that role, if we were to get rid of Jabari, which... I mean, I like Jabari. He's from Chicago. But he's not Zion Williamson. No, I'm kidding. I'm not going to go all out. But if we don't pick up the contracts of Cameron Payne, Justin Holiday, and we find a way to cut Felicio, they can have $35 to $53 million if they were to get rid of Jabari. So, and that's with the 2019-2020 cap, which is going to rise to $109 million. The Bulls could possibly get this, Kevin Durant, Klay Thompson. I mean, pairing that with Zion Williamson and the core that they already have,
the possibilities are endless.
Exactly. And that's why the Bulls need a tank. And if anyone comes at me and says, oh, well, the Bulls need to win a game, I think with new head coach, they can, you know, pull out a win and show who they got. No, why would you want to?
Is there something in the water at United Center this year? I mean, what's going on with the two teams?
I know. It's
exactly. Yeah. I mean, I would
maybe
love...
they serve too much romaine lettuce.
Oh, I mean, Chicago does order that a lot.
Because they're playing like crap.
I had to use that romaine lettuce at my pizza job a lot.
Did you?
Yeah, we had to, like, every sandwich had romaine lettuce. I'm being for real. And I'm sure that's what it is.
You think it's the romaine?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, we have 9 minutes remaining. And oh, Rob... God. Nathan. Anyway, you know, like we said earlier, this is Rob's last show. So I want to end on, you know, kind of a more of a, I guess, lower, not so hostile note. Rob, I just want to say thank you because for those who don't know, I'm going to tell a little story here. As I came in last year as a freshman and I was doing live at Five Sports. And so that to me was a big start. And really, it meant a lot to be able to have that opportunity. It was a blessing. But what really made it special was having people like Rob come in and voluntarily give their time to help these freshmen that would, you know, lead the organization coming up. And 3 weeks into my position as sports anchor on Tuesdays, Rob comes up to me and Steven Sobeck as well. And they say, you know, Blake, we like what you've done so far on Live at 5. You sound really good. How about coming and try and shadowing the Fantasy Express? And for me, you know, I was like, well, what's the Fantasy Express? And, you know, they expanded on it a little bit. Sports talk show. They get pretty truthful with things. And that seemed to fit my personality. So I went ahead and I gave it a try. And let me tell you, that might have been the highlight of my freshman year and one of the most memorable moments that I've had coming up in, you know, my whole college career to this point. So that was special to me to have an upperclassman like that realize, you know, focus on and see, you know, that this person could potentially do good things and want to teach them as opposed to hindering someone that may be, you know, a threat or just somebody else that's in the industry. No, it's embracing that and being able to take someone under your wing and teach people how to do things the right way in today's day and age is something that's lost and doesn't happen quite often. So I want to thank you, Rob, for that, because that really meant a lot to me. And I don't know if I've ever been able to express that to you. You've not only done that either. That's not even half of it. That doesn't even scratch the surface. You've come up to me in NewsLink when I didn't know how to use Avid. I didn't know how to even cut a video. And you sat down and you wrote me handwritten instructions on how to do everything. And, you know, not a lot of people knew me at the time. I was still getting my feet wet. And really, you set the tone and helped me do what I now have grown to love to do, giving me resume advice. You know, you've helped me on my LinkedIn profile, which I now have an all-star profile. So thank you for that. And it doesn't stop at me either. There have been several other students that I've seen you do the same thing for, whether it be helping people with their resume, helping people job search. And, you know, I can tell you that I'm not the only person that, you know, from the bottom of their hearts, thanks you for that, because that means more than can be expressed in words to really get someone going in their career that wants to succeed. So I want to thank you for that. You've been more than a good colleague. You've been a great friend, and I'm going to miss you next year and next semester. So thank you so much. And we've got a little something for you too. So, so hang on, you guys hold the mic. Don't let us get too much dead air. All right.
Well, thank you so much, Blake. That really means a lot. You know, coming on to WCRD a few seasons or a few years ago, I was
Speaking
a sophomore.
Of sports seasons.
I was a sophomore and I was an entertainment anchor, and that's pretty much all I did in college other than, you know, report for NewsLink. And then I reported for the 2016 election coverage, and that's what really got it started. I became the lead reporter. I started to do news anchoring that next semester. And then from there, it was just, I mean, everything. I became a producer. I became the social media director for last semester, and now the executive producer for the news team. So just the radio station has given me a lot of opportunities. There's been a lot of people that have come in. You mentioned Steven Sobeck. He's one of those guys. He brought me on.
It's just a chain reaction.
Exactly.
Positivity breeds positivity. And that's, you know, again, we can't thank you enough. And, you know, like you said, the 2016 election coverage that you did, I actually watched that last year before really getting into anything because I didn't really know you too well. We had talked sports before every Live at 5 when you were social media director. And, you know, that's about all I knew about you. But, you know, as we went along and we built a good friendship, and I think it's one that can last a lifetime, and, you know, working with you has truly been a pleasure. So, Nathan, I'll let you go ahead and do the honors here.
Before I present our little gift to you, thanks a lot, Rob. Just as a person who's not in a news major or sports major, it's been really nice to have you be supportive of me wanting to try something different and really enjoying myself doing it. And it's been a blast working with you at Live at 5. So thanks so much, man.
For sure, man. I mean, I remember at the beginning of the semester when I saw your name in the sports section of the whole scheduling, I was like, Nathan Gidley is doing sports? That's awesome. And just hearing you the whole semester just write these awesome segments that, I mean, there would be like 5 to 10 minutes of just pure sports knowledge. And I think that's the beauty.
He's fantastic.
Yeah, that's the beauty of doing radio or TV in college. I mean, you get to go past your boundaries. And, you know, as a great meteorologist that you are, you still go up and you do sports just as well. I mean, I just love you guys so much. I love everyone at WCRD, at Ball State, with the different organizations, and it's just been a pleasure.
It has absolutely been a pleasure. So, Nathan, I'm going to toss the basketball. There's for our Ditto Cam. We got a little basketball.
That's for you, man.
Rob, he loves to talk basketball. The Segovia sweep, that's right. And Rob, he always loves to talk basketball, and he always said to me before every show, you know, NFL's not my favorite. I want to talk basketball. I love the playoffs. I love everything about it. So, Rob, that's our token, the slightest token of appreciation we can give to you. And we got you a card as well. So, you know, just we want you to know that we appreciate what you've done for us and really setting the foundation for us to be able to carry this show through the future. It truly means a lot.
It means a lot, guys. Thank you for the basketball. I really want to play with it. Yeah. Come summertime. I'm not going to play with it outside right now because it was snowing, but I'm definitely going to do that. Thank you guys for the card. I'm going to open up later when we're not doing the radio show so I can cry a little.
Yeah, that's
but yeah, it's been a pleasure, and I know you guys are going to do a fantastic job next season.
Thank you. And
I'll hear about you balling out there in Texas.
That's right.
We're those nights.
Old El Paso is going to – they're not going to see what hit them. Now,
nope.
So – again, that's, you know, that's the Fantasy Express. Rob, thank you so much for everything you've done for us. It truly means a lot. We look forward to next semester, but at the same time, it hurts to see you go. So we're going to do the best to carry on this show as well as you set it up for us. And, you know, beyond our years, we'd love to keep it going as well. So if you ever happen to be in town, around at Ball State, whatever the case is, if you're here, we want you to come and make a guest appearance on the Fantasy Express. Consider this your lifetime invite.
That's awesome, man. That's all I wanted. You know, last year I was talking to Steve, and we wanted to continue this for a long time. I mean, just come back 5 to 10 years later and still see the Fantasy Express. So the fact that you guys are going to carry it on means a lot.
And we definitely, you know, as soon as you're out, we're going to be, and I know this sounds bad, as soon as we're out, you're out, we're going to find someone new, but no, you know, it means more than that. We want to find someone to continue on the legacy that you've left. And those are big shoes to fill, but we're up to the task. And I can promise you one thing, that if nothing else, we're going to give you our best effort and keep the Fantasy Express in good hands.
Awesome. Thank you, guys.
I'm really excited, and I appreciate everything you've done, Rob. It's been a blast.
And like we said, you know, Nathan coming on next semester. Nathan, I want to thank you for being able to do this, because let me tell you, it was an absolute pain trying to find someone, because there's no replacing Rob Segovia. I mean, it's not possible.
That's true.
He does a great job, and, you know, finding someone who could, you know, come in and fill the shoes as well as Nathan has, it's truly a blessing, and I couldn't have asked for any more. So, unfortunately, we're out of time. That's a wrap. Rob, why don't you go ahead and send us off for one last show
on
the Fantasy Express?
All right, so until next season, this has been the Fantasy Express on 91.3 WCRD. I'm Rob Segovia with Nathan Gidley and Blake, the Hound Dog Dollar. Good night.